In that whole thing, he was talking about like softening styles, aerating the space between. I'm like, this is good.
That's the language I use.
Everybody, and welcome to episode 33 of the vlog. Wait, is this episode? All right, so we are here today at Thoughtium headquarters in Fulton Market, Chicago, and we are so excited to have a very special guest in Jeff Davis. Jeff is an author, he is an entrepreneur,
yes.
He's a podcaster, and he's an old friend,
yes.
I guess you could say.
Yes.
And we're just super excited to have him on the show today. We're gonna talk everything about entrepreneurship, writing a book, and how to get started. Let's get into it. So Jeff, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Sure, so that's a long answer probably, but to spare the people that are listening, I'll give the short one. So right now I am a sales and marketing alignment expert. I'm really passionate about helping B2B organizations strategically align sales and marketing to effectively drive growth. My background started as an engineer in undergrad, which a lot of people don't know. Mm-hmm. They're like, sales, marketing, how does that all fit together? However, once I got out of engineering, I actually went into sales and I said, worst case scenario, if I really, really suck at this, I'll go back to engineering and pretend like it didn't happen. But ended up actually really clicking and did very well in sales. And then we actually met during our time in healthcare sales. And I think that was the spark that allowed me to see that there was a disconnect, a fundamental disconnect between sales and marketing. And so fast forward, and we'll probably get into more of the details. Yep. I went through a couple different organizations and said, like, this is pervasive. And so at some point in my life, I said, you know, instead of complaining, I'm going to figure this out.
Yes.
And so that's what I have been doing for the last several years.
Yeah, it's incredible. You are in such an interesting niche. And I think it will be a topic that's very interesting to a lot of our audience. So we want to get into that in a second, but I want to connect our past.
Yes.
Because one of the things that I love about the vlog is that I'm able to call on different corners of my network from different parts of my life who are all doing some incredible things, and we get to kind of go back and retrace our steps. So, you know, you and I both were connected through really the beginning of my career, probably the beginning of your career,
yeah,
as well too, in healthcare sales, as you had mentioned.
Yep.
We both were pharmaceutical sales reps.
We were.
And we talked today about how that was such a formative time in our career for a couple of reasons. For me particularly, it was around the ability to really put myself out there, have different discussions with, you know, clients and customers, cut my teeth in sales, but most importantly, and this is what you and I connect on, the training that we received,
yeah,
at our first landing spot in healthcare sales, which was Pfizer Pharmaceuticals, was just top notch. And I call on that experience so much, and I want you to maybe speak to that experience for you and how it still impacts the way that you go about your day today.
Yeah, so I think having that fundamental training, like, you know, as many people say, Pfizer training was really, really hardcore. And I didn't realize that I appreciated it until really I moved on and started doing, working with other organizations and interacting with other people, is that the intensity of that training and program, you know, and you remember this, that you had to pass tests. And if you didn't pass the test,
yep,
you didn't have a job.
Yeah.
So it wasn't like, you know, rah, rah, let's get together and learn some, you know, some training.
Yep.
It was like you really had to come in and be a subject matter expert, which, you know, I think is more important today than ever. And I think by virtue that I started my career that way, it's an assumption for me that when you're interacting with a client, that you have to know not only your product and solutions and service, but their business as well,
mm-hmm,
in order to really provide value. So
yeah.
I would tell you, I refer back to my Pfizer training all the time.
Yeah.
And I look at people sometimes, I'm like, you wouldn't have cut the mustard. You would have been fired.
Well, it was interesting. So for me, my experience at Pfizer really planted the seed for really the rest of my career, which,
yeah,
is to go deep in this learning and development space. And I think I was influenced very greatly by not only the program that Pfizer had to offer, but also the caliber of people that were delivering those learning and development experiences.
Absolutely.
And I joke today that, you know, back then Pfizer was so big that, you know, we would go and our classes would be hundreds of people,
yeah,
you know, and we'd all be in this location, you know, training for an entire summer. the trainers themselves almost had a celebrity type kind of aura to them.
I actually still remember my trainer.
Right, and yeah. and for me, you know, to know that handful of folks had such an impact on my career to the point where I could recall their names today. Yeah. And actually I run into them now, you know, in different areas of life sciences, and some are even clients of mine. They've just had such an incredible impact because, you know, they really taught me how to go deep in my knowledge. They taught me the rigor and the discipline it takes to actually really learn products in a way that we can present them with value to our customers. Yep. And at the end of the day, like, it was where I fell in love with the learning process. And for that, I'm glad that you and I are connected.
Yes.
And it's really cool to kind of think back to those days.
Yeah. I mean, what a different world. I tell you, I look back with all, like, just such a good time of my career. And I don't even think I appreciated at the time how lucky I was to start my sales career at that, yep, at Pfizer, and really get that foundation, because it has completely changed the game for
me. Yeah, it's incredible. So. Well, and I am now you fast forward almost 10 years, and I'm also super excited that you and I are almost on a completely different kind of plane from where we started our careers. Like, you know, big organization, yep, you know, big sales organization, again, like, extremely valuable. And over the course of the last 10 years, I have really converged on narrowing in on my true passion, which really is in building a business and bringing people in, and, you know, now consulting organizations like Pfizer. And for you, you've picked a really interesting niche yourself. And it's really around aligning teams, important teams within these organizations. So talk a little bit about your vocation in aligning sales and marketing, because I think your message is so clear, and I'd love for you to share it a little bit.
Sure. Today. And so, you know, a lot of people ask me, why did you start your business? Why did you pick this work? And, you know, I could come up with this convoluted, you know, answer, but really it was out of frustration. Mm-hmm. So for me, you know, coming from a sales organization, going to business school to transform myself into a marketer, part of which I was selfishly doing because I wanted to advocate for salespeople in the corporate setting and be in those meetings, those brand team meetings, to have a voice for sales in the strategy development.
Yep.
And when I got there, I realized that these people are all working really hard and have the best intentions, but there's a level of empathy that is missing because they don't understand truly what the other needs. And it wasn't that they weren't amazing at what they did. That just always struck me as, like, we could both be so much more effective if we really were in communication and understood how we could leverage each other.
Yep.
And so it wasn't about, like, sales and marketing getting along, which is great, and I don't have a problem with that. But when I'm talking to CEOs and business leaders, I'm talking about helping your people understand how to leverage the business relationship to make them both more effective in their functions and then the overall to accelerate revenue growth. So what I did was I said, I've got to figure this out for myself. Because what I was seeing in the marketplace was a little light, but I said, I don't want to bog down practitioners, because the last thing I need to do is stop the revenue engine and then do all this other stuff. So it really is about helping them understand, how do you incrementally make changes that will overall make you more effective. So that's
so interesting. And I want to maybe get real specific and tactical here, and I'll refer back to, you know, our time working for a large organization. Sales and marketing worked differently 15 years ago than it did today. And the way that I experienced it as a sales rep in a large sales organization was, you know, marketing kind of sat up here, and they made big decisions based on insights, qualitative, quantitative research. They put together a marketing plan at the beginning of the year, or maybe twice a year, and we were then shipped essentially a box of the assets that we had. And those assets, I mean, we had very little input on the messaging and the tools that we were provided. And we trusted that, you know, these marketing teams were making the right decisions. And for all intents and purposes, they probably were.
Yeah.
But it was so mindless for us. Like, we were so detached from the brand development process and the marketing process. We just knew that box was coming twice a year, and we knew that, like, we had to learn and we had to go and disseminate that message. How is it different today?
So it's interesting, because I wrote the title of the book very purposely, and I don't know if everybody noticed it. Mm-hmm. So there's actually two titles, because there's two transformations that are happening. So when you look at the B2B space, sales and marketing, the individual functions, have to transform the way in which they engage with the modern buyer, right? Sales cannot sell like they did 3, 4, 5 years ago, and marketing can't either.
So that's the first part of togetherness?
That's the first part of togetherness. Okay. So in an individual function, you as a sales leader, you as a marketing leader, have to recognize that digital disruption has completely changed the game. The buyer-seller relationship is completely different, and that they're coming to the table with so much more information that us going back into the whole, like I call it the used car salesman, here are my features and benefits and why you should buy our product. We don't mean to do that, but to the modern buyer, that's what we sound like, because they're like, well, I already did my research. I know all that stuff. Mm-hmm. I went to your site, I went to all these third-party sites. You have to do more for me. Mm-hmm. So that's the first transformation.
Okay.
And then the second one is, in order to really be able to provide the experiences that we have come to know as the norm, right? So we have Zappos and Amazon, all these really great buying experiences. We bring that expectation to work with us as B2B buyers. We have this weird thing where we think that you come to work and all of a sudden you don't make decisions in the same way as you do outside of work. Yep. We're humans, right? Yep. And so while you may, you know, say that, you know, you make a B2B decision based on logic, that's not true. Mm-hmm. You do it on emotion first, and then you back up and justify with logic so that you can make sure that you're covering all your bases. So I say all this to say, I wrote the title being very intentional, and that helping leaders understand there's two things happening at once, which is why it is difficult, because you have a lot of moving parts. So individual functional silos have to transform the way that they're going to market, and then in order for them to really engage the modern buyer and help them get through that buying journey, they're gonna have to come together and create a whole cohesive system.
Incredible. Tell our audience how you work with your clients. Like what's the typical engagement look like, or is there a typical engagement?
Yeah, so typical engagement is, we believe in that you can have the best marketing strategy or best sales strategy, but if the system itself is broken and doesn't work together cohesively, you'll never be able to optimize your impact on revenue, right? So we have to first understand how to build a system. In many organizations, they don't realize that while you have a sales and marketing team that get along, you don't fundamentally have a system that works cohesively together. I use the word that a lot of sales and marketing teams have a dysfunctional relationship, and people stereotypically think that I mean combative, like they fight or they hate each other. I was like, no, they just don't understand how to leverage each other. So for us coming in, we do a full assessment of the sales and marketing alignment functions. And so what we're really looking for is to see, how do you work together as a system first? Before we evaluate strategy, before we evaluate whether or not you're going around the right people, we have to make sure that we understand what is the system working.
Yep.
And then from there, we help our organizations prioritize what they need to work on first in order to be able to move the needle. Because at the end of the day, it's about revenue.
Yeah.
And while strategy is important, and we get into that, I want to help our leaders that we interact with understand what can you do tomorrow to make impact, and then we provide them with a roadmap that shows this is now, this is next, this is, you know, year out, whatever. Yeah. So there's a cadence there.
Yeah, and you know, this is really where, you know, your work intersects with ours at ThoughtTeam. You know, we work with leaders and teams of leaders within organizations to develop long-term strategy.
Yeah.
So mission, vision, strategic imperatives, what are the big rocks that are gonna get you from today to where you wanna be 3 to 5 years from now? And a major ingredient of that is cross-functional collaboration. So we bring the concept to these leaders and we show them that the work in the horizontal across functions is just as important and sometimes even more important than your focus vertically. Sure. It opens a lot of really good discussion, and oftentimes we're able to influence our clients to meet in different ways or establish some sort of governance around the concept of cross-functional collaboration. But it's another thing then to go in and actually apply tools and systems and frameworks that really enable it, and it sounds like that's the work that you do.
Absolutely, and the thing that we have to keep in mind when we're talking to our clients is that sales marketing alignment for a lot of people has been, it's been around and talked about for quite some time.
It's always a concept.
It's always a concept. Yeah. The relationship's been broken for decades, but our approach to it is really, we are talking about its impact on productivity and financial growth. Mm. Revenue growth, because people don't realize when you have a misaligned system between sales and marketing, you are unable to really unlock your growth potential. Mm-hmm. And there is a significant and negative impact not only on your ability to drive revenue, but also culture. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, when we may get into that later in our conversation. And so what I am starting with conversations is, let's not just talk about sales and marketing working together, but let's talk about not taking action and the impact it has on you to be A, competitive, B, drive revenue, and C, have a great culture where you really are attracting people that do great work.
I love that. And so that's actually where I want to go with this, because when I see create togetherness, and I know that in the context of sales and marketing alignment, it's extremely important, but the meaning and the impact of togetherness, I mean, it touches on so many other things. Yeah. And I'm seeing so many organizations now focus very intently on building culture and values, and like culture and values that stick and that are real and that are truly representative of the organization as opposed to bought off the shelf.
Yeah.
How can we leverage this concept of togetherness in a broader scope with organizations? What's the bigger meaning? Because I know it's not just sales and marketing alignment.
It's not. And I chose that word purposely
as
well.
It's so great.
And so I think you zoom out twice. I think you zoom out to the large organization. And you know, I like the phrase soften the silos. I would push back against people that say we have to absolutely blow up silos. Yeah. Because we got to think about the context in which it came into existence. So we had these centers of excellence back in the day that allowed us to really understand how to be great at sales, how to be great at marketing, operations, whatever that may be. That thought leadership and that knowledge is important. But when I say soften the silos, what I mean is we have to aerate them so that we're communicating cross functions so that we can collectively do better work. Mm-hmm. Because operating in that way does not work anymore. Mm. And then I think if you zoom out one more time and you look at it more globally, you know, it goes back to that, like 1 + 1 = 3, right?
Yeah.
We do better work. You are more efficient. You are more productive when you understand how you connect to everybody within your network, whether it be at work, whether it be at school, whether it be in your community, whether it be in your family. And so I really, you know, want to, you know, there's an underlying kind of current message that I want people to realize that this goes beyond business. It's just like, when we really understand where we all kind of fit in the matrix and how we can help each other and leverage each other, everybody does better work. And that really is the essence of what creating togetherness is.
It's so interesting. You know, you say, I love that term, soften the silos, and I'm immediately applying it to even my personal life. Like, my family needs that concept, right? Like, soften the silos, people. You know, we all are leading different lives, but it's really important to be able to just not necessarily, you know, blow up our stance or, you know, our beliefs that develop over time, but to your point, to kind of create a little bit of aeration, a little bit of air that allows for meaningful communication to go back.
Because I think you guys use a phrase, up and out.
We do.
Which look I up love. And it's a very similar concept. Is that, you know, I picture you like at the cubicle like this. I'm like, just pop up.
Look up and out.
And just see what other people are doing in the context of what you're doing. And just, so it's a very similar concept.
Yeah, that's incredible.
Yeah.
So Create Togetherness is the book. It's also the brand. Tell us about some of the decisions that you've made to create this arc of, you know, starting your independent consultancy and then starting this concept of togetherness, sales and marketing alignment, and then writing a book and getting into podcasts, because I just, I'm so curious and I give you a lot of credit for being so intentional.
Yeah, so for me, when I considered, you know, starting my own business or, you know, independent consultancy, I really thought about what am I uniquely qualified to do? Like, what unique experiences, perspectives, outlook do I have that will provide value with people, right? And so I've been in sales, I've been in marketing, I've been in business development. Could I start a basket weaving company? Probably. I would figure out a brand.
There's YouTube videos for that.
Yeah, there's YouTube videos for that. But I think my marketing background and being a marketer, it's in my DNA to be really thoughtful about, like, how do I package this and make this all cohesive and work?
Yeah.
Because the first thing that I feel as a marketer, especially if you're starting a new business, is to be all over the place. It's like a death trap because no one understands the value that you provide. And so for me, I said, you know, really where I come from, I was that weird person. It's a little bit more common now, but back then, like, you stayed in sales and you stayed in marketing.
Yeah,
like, you didn't cross the chasm, so to say.
Yep.
And so I was very intentional about, like, I really want to go into marketing. I think I can provide value. I can learn a lot in marketing. And so when I stepped back, I said, I went super niche because I felt like for my business it was going to really provide me with the lane that I needed in order to gain traction. And to your point about kind of going wide in the beginning, I think for business owners that don't quite know what they want to do, I'm okay with you starting that way, but you need to quickly understand, like, if things are not working, you pivot. And then you, like you said, laser focus in and just do what you're good at, because when you do too much, you truly don't add value.
Yep.
And so for me, my thing was, I'm sales and marketing alignment, that's what I do. I've had opportunities to do other things, and, you know, it was tough, especially in the beginning of the business, turn those things down, but I knew they weren't aligned with where my skill set was and where I added the most value for clients. And so everything I do, to your point, really is about me thinking through, being very intentional about who my client is. I knew they were head of sales, head of marketing, and the CEO. They were worried about, you know, our impact on revenue, the fact that we had declining revenue, declining market share, whatever that is. And I continue to ask myself, what do you need to know? How can I help you think differently to impact your business? Mm-hmm. And so I only do things that are in line with that. And so thus you see the podcast where we only talk about sales, marketing, alignment. Like I can talk about 20,000 different subjects. I think where I went a little bit of a different way with my podcast is I want to have a more inclusive conversation about a specific topic.
Yeah.
Right? So I have sales leaders, I have marketing leaders, I have CEOs, I have psychologists, neurologists, all the people that may not have ever been in the same room. Mm-hmm. I said, I want to bring you all to the table to talk about the same topic because I guarantee you every time you guys talk, somebody in a different role is going to hear it something different that they didn't think about because you're out of their function.
Yeah.
And so that really was why I kind of did that. And then the book for me was how do I put all of this learning, my personal experiences, interactions with clients, podcast conversations, blog, all of that stuff, how do I make that really consumable for somebody in a really easy, quick way? That's how the book was born.
Incredible. So the book is Create Togetherness. And I want to ask you a question. So
sure.
I can't wait to read this.
Thank you.
So thank you for the copies.
You're very welcome.
And I'm actually looking forward to potentially giving these out to a few of our clients because I think this topic is just so pertinent. And this body of work looks extremely valuable and also just very approachable.
Thank you.
So I want to give you kudos for the book. For those of us out there that have a like a seed in the back of our mind that we'd want to write a book someday, which is probably everybody, right? Or a lot of people, especially entrepreneurs. Maybe what is the one thing about writing a book that you know today that you didn't know going into it?
That's a good question. So a couple answers to that. I think that what I learned is that the process is harder than you think. And mind you, I had informational interviews with a lot of business authors that are extremely successful. And they gave me like the real deal. This is what the process is. This is what you're going to go through. And even with that knowledge, until you're in it, you don't know.
Yeah.
And so what I encourage people is be very thoughtful about why you want to write the book. Mm-hmm. If it's purely to share your thought leadership, great. If it's to make money, that's a different strategy. If it's to extend your brand in order for you to get into better conversations or get more speaking gig, be thoughtful about that upfront because it will impact and it will shape the way that you approach the book writing process.
Yep.
I'd say for me, and I've had a lot of people since the book has come out, entrepreneurs and other folks that are interested in writing, the length in which it took to write the book. I quote people 6 to 12 months if you're starting from scratch. For me, it was about 6 months because I had already been writing. I've been blogging. I've been writing articles for folks. I had already started the podcast. I already had been speaking. So for me, it was about really crystallizing all of these conversations and thoughts that I had into a body of work, which I found to be helpful for me because it really helped me crystallize my perspective.
You had already put some reps in. Yeah,
you got
that's great.
You got
that's
it.
Really interesting. So thank you for that advice.
Yeah.
I'll say we talked about this earlier. Today, there's no better time than today, I believe, to be an entrepreneur because we have the tools and the resources, the internet, the ability to publish books in a way that we couldn't 10 or 15, 20 years ago. I think it also comes with a really unique challenge in that we do have access to all of these channels.
Almost too much.
And it is almost too much. It challenges us to really refine not only our value proposition, but the way that we are kind of piping it out there. And I know that there is a school of thought that just says, create, document, put it out there. But when it comes to something like a book, like this thing will not sell or provide value unless it has real specific value.
Yeah.
Right? So it's almost like anybody can write a book, but the fun challenge today is how do you cut through a lot of that volume? And I think this has a real shot. I know that it's
Thank
already
you.
Gotten some pretty incredible traction. I want to congratulate you not only for the book,
but
for the successful business. So Jeff, how can they find you and how can they find this book?
The book is available at createtogetherness.com. There's also corresponding merchandise at createtogetherness.com. And the best way to find me is at meetjeffdavis.com. I have all of my content, the blog, the links to the book, where I'm speaking, all that kind of good stuff. And then you can also find me on LinkedIn. I'm really, really active on LinkedIn. If you put in JD2 Consulting Group, we will pop up.
That's incredible. And I hope you all do find Jeff and all of his incredible content. It's really, really valuable stuff, not just for sales and marketing leaders, but for business leaders in general.
Absolutely.
We are so, so excited to have you on the vlog. We look forward to potentially having you back again.
Yeah, I'll be back.
Absolutely. And you know, this vlog, this platform, like today, will always be a platform for our friends, other leaders in the industry to come on and share their voice. And we're just so happy and excited for you to share yours. We look forward to continuing to do that on an episode by episode basis. Enjoy your day, everybody.